My name is Stephanie Caldwell, and I am the President and CEO of the Ventura Chamber of Commerce, and we have just a wonderful program, so thank you for being here today. To get things started, if you'll please join me and stand as we salute the flag. Hand over your heart, ready? Begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So I'd like to start off this morning by introducing some folks that we have joining us today. Mayor Eric Nazarenko, right there in the back of the room. Welcome. Thank you for being here. We have several of our council members here in Ventura. Councilmember Cheryl Heitman. Councilmember Christy Weir. And also our city manager, Mark Watkins. And representing Assemblymember Doss Williams, we have Angelica Cisneros. Representing Assemblymember Jackie Irwin, we have Jeanette Sanchez. Representing State Senator Hannah Beth Jackson, we have Michael McDonald. Representing Congresswoman Julia Brownlee, we have Brad Hudson. And representing County Supervisor Steve Bennett, we have Steve Offerman. We also have a number of the Ventura Unified School District Board of Trustees members here, so if you can stand as I say your name. Barbara Fitzgerald, Debbie Golden, Mary Hafner, and Velma Lomax. Thank you all for joining us today. So, you know, obviously education is a critical component to our community, and the conversation that we're having today is really exploring pathways and partnerships. And we have a number of questions. I hope that as you hear the panelists, you will maybe come up with some of your questions as well. We will do our best to get as many questions from the audience as we can. But again, this idea of exploring these pathways and partnerships is to really look at how the business community can engage with our education community to really prepare the workforce, not just for today and tomorrow, but for our future needs as well. So please join us in the conversation, and we love your feedback. So after the event, as you come up with ideas, let us know, and we'll be looking at this year round. A few more folks that I want to recognize before I turn the program over are our chamber board. And I know we have several of our chamber board members here, so if you could please stand. Thank you for being here. And with that, I would like to welcome up our Chamber Board Chair for 2016, James Pereiro, with Myers, Witters, Gibson, Jones, and Feingold.
Thank you, Stephanie. Welcome, everyone. We're so glad you could join us today for this great event. For those of you that have been attending some chamber events this year, you know that our four priorities for the chamber, the things we're focusing on in particular, are improving the permitting process in Ventura, attracting high-growth businesses and entrepreneurs to our community, broadening our membership, and addressing and engaging with the issue of homelessness in our community. These are all things that matter to our members. These are matters of concern to the business community, and they are, of course, all quality of life issues for the city of Ventura. Now, of course, education is part and parcel to that. If we want to have people who are trained and ready to enter the workforce and support the economy that's going to create and support a vibrant community, we need to have people who are well-trained and well-educated. I'm the product of educators. I grew up in a household with people who, quote-unquote, talk for a living. So that's what my father always said. My mom has spent her career in early childhood education, and my dad is a retired public high school teacher in social studies. So I'm a strong believer in the importance of good public educational opportunities and the role that that plays in our community. And that's why I'm so glad to be associated with a Chamber of Commerce that has those values and really cares about that and is invested in the local schools and understands the importance of the local schools to all of our quality of life and the local economy. So before we get into our program and before we introduce the panelists, I've got a few folks I'd like to thank. These are businesses, entities, organizations that have made this event possible today. I'd like to thank and acknowledge our event sponsors. First of all, our presenting sponsor, and hold your applause until the end, I'll cue that. Our presenting sponsor is Brooks Institute. Our gold sponsors are Era Energy and Kaiser Permanente. Our bronze sponsors are Gold Coast Acura, Tolman and Weicker Insurance Services LLC, and Ventura Community Bank. And our media sponsors are Caps Media and Ventura Breeze. Let's give them a round of applause. And now I'd like to thank and acknowledge our Chairman's Circle members, and again, please hold your applause until the end. At the Diamond level, Brooks Institute. At the Gold level, AT&T, Community Memorial Health System, Kaiser Permanente, and Ventura County Star. At the Silver level, Era and Montecito Bank and Trust. At the Bronze level, E.J. Harrison, California Resources Corporation, CSU Channel Islands, Gold Coast Acura, Gold Coast Transit, Hofer Enterprises, Marriott Ventura Beach, Myers Witters Gibson Jones and Fine Gold LLP, Pacific Western Bank, Southern California Edison, Swift Chip, Tolman and Weicker, Union Bank, Ventura Community Bank, Ventura County Credit Union, Ventura Rental Party Center, Western States Petroleum Association, and as our media sponsors, Caps Media, VC Reporter, Ventura Breeze, and Lunar's Production Services. Let's give all of our Chairman's Circle members a round of applause. And now I'd like to invite a representative of our presenting sponsor, Brooks Institute, Steve Hammaker, to come and share a few words. He's their Director of Finance and Operations.
Thank you for having us here. My name is Steve Hammaker. I've been with Brooks for 12 years now, and I am the Director of Finance and Operations, as was stated. I'm also the designated stand-in this afternoon for our president, Ed Clift. Brooks Institute was founded 70 years ago in Santa Barbara. Over time, as Brooks grew, Santa Barbara and Brooks, those names became identified with each other. And when I traveled and mentioned that I was from Brooks, I would often get the response of Santa Barbara, and vice versa. When I told people that I was from Santa Barbara, they would say Brooks. 70 years is a long time to develop that relationship and that association, and it was it developed very well. While Brooks has been part of the Ventura community for 10 years and has participated beneficially with the community, it wasn't until a lot more recently that this became our home. The culmination of that Ventura home is the move this year from our rural campus to a downtown urban walking campus in Ventura. We're proud to be able to offer our students the dynamic learning environment that provides, and we want to thank the city for their vision and efforts in making this happen and bringing us together. Ventura and Brooks will both gain from this partnership. Very few of our students are local, and they have come from just about everywhere. Our alumni are in all 50 states, and they span the globe. There's about 12,000 in all. Currently, we operate in 3 states, 4 countries, and we're traveling to more all the time. This summer, we have classes going to France for fashion photography. We have them going to New Zealand for documentary. Our president, Ed Clift, he's known as Eddie, just got back from China recently, and he's currently in Germany, which is why I have the privilege of standing in front of you today. I'll be happy to introduce you to him when he gets back. Everything we do, everyone we communicate with, everywhere we go, we will carry our new association with Ventura. We desire to enhance Ventura as a destination with our expansion offerings in education and art. We know that Ventura will reflect well on Brooks. It already has. And we hope to demonstrably do the same for Ventura as we go forward. I also have found a new home. I moved to Ventura 2 years ago. So my hope is that when I'm traveling soon, that I will hear Ventura associated with Brooks and Brooks associated with Ventura when they're mentioned. Ed wanted to make sure that everyone knew that we had a new home in Ventura, and part of that was involving us more in the community here in Ventura. This sponsorship is an example of that commitment. We're proud to be a sponsor and look forward to participation with the Chamber. You can follow our downtown move at brooks.edu. On a final thought, as an introduction to Brooks, please stop by the table in the registration area for a complimentary coffee mug or documentary book. Next time you see them, they'll probably be for sale in our Welcome Center, so this may be a truly a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Steve. And now I'd like to invite our panelists to step forward and go ahead and take a seat here on the dais. And the way that we're going to do this is once they sit down, I will read their bio individually and then give each of them an opportunity to share some introductory remarks. So we'll do that, and then we'll get going. So our first panelist is Dr. Bernard Luskin. He's the Chancellor of the Ventura County Community College District. He's been CEO of 8 colleges and universities, including President of Oxnard, Moorpark, Orange Coast, and Coastline Community Colleges, Chancellor of Jones International University, CEO of Toro University Worldwide, and President of Wright Graduate University. He taught at UCLA, USC, Claremont Graduate University, Pepperdine University, Toro University, California State University at Fullerton and Los Angeles, and the Fielding and Claremont Graduate Universities. In the private sector, Dr. Luskin has been president and CEO of divisions of Fortune 500 companies, including Philips Interactive Media and Jones International, as well as Mind Extension University, Knowledge TV, and Jones Educational Networks. He is an author, a Navy veteran, and an Emmy winner. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Luskin. If you'd like to share some introductory remarks,
Feel free. Okay. I thought I was going to answer questions, but that's okay.
That's coming. Don't worry.
I'm sure. I'm more than delighted to be here, and especially delighted. And I just want to comment that with us today is Bernardo Perez, who's a trustee at the Ventura County Community College District, and our board chair, Larry Kennedy, who is the chair of the board and a trustee of Ventura County Community College District. And I'm delighted to be on the panel with President Gillespie and have this meeting hosted at Ventura College, partly because I'm an alumni of Ventura College, so my life has gone full circle. You know, I was a student, and now I'm chancellor, so, you know, that's the story, my life in a nutshell. I live here in Ventura County, and my wife and I came back in, it was actually 1999, and so we came to stay, so we're not leaving anymore, regardless. I think Ventura County is a sleeper. It's got an unusual profile. I don't want to go on and on because it's going to be a panel and we'll get to questions. The potential here is quite extraordinary. I have had a couple of unique life experiences. I'll ask my assistant, we'll shorten that resume a little bit. It's a little embarrassing, but because I've been around a long time. I grew up in Los Angeles, and when I went to Orange County, I was president of Orange Coast College and Coastline Community College and so forth during the boom in Orange County. And so I experienced the dramatic growth, and I was right in the middle of it, and then life changed, and did a number of things and came here to Ventura. And I never really understood why the same boom didn't happen in Ventura, but now I understand from SOARs and all the protection that is here that this is a wonderful place, and it's been cared for and protected very carefully by a lot of people who care about the quality of life here, because this is one of the best places to live on the planet, period. There's and we those of us who are here really understand that. So we need to take care of it. This now, this is all about jobs and workforce. I understand. I think the topic today has to do with that. So I'm not going to over elaborate that part, but I will say something about the Ventura County Community College District, and I'll say just a word more about Ventura. Ventura is an interesting county. That was my point. And since I get to be the opening person, we're nestled between Los Angeles and Santa Barbara. So Ventura has not had the high profile that L.A. or Santa Barbara has. But it's just really beyond special. My comment really is related to the Community College District. We have three colleges, Moore Park, Oxnard, and Ventura College. And so there's a college in driving distance of every citizen in this community. And we have some centers that are evolving that are quite significant, and I'm sure Dr. Gillespie will comment about those. But the point is, we're the nexus for jobs and employment in the county, I think. I just put some information together. I'm going to talk to the grand jury next Tuesday, not in a negative way, as an information item to go in to describe the district. So I found out we have over 60 technical occupational programs in our colleges here. And so that's the opportunity for people who live in this county. I was talking with President Gillespie because we're active in workforce activities in the county. I think Trustee Perez, you were on the Workforce Investment Board. Chair Kennedy comes out of occupational technical education, taught at Oxnard College for more than 30 years. And so we're active in every area. The point being, there are a lot of jobs. There are a lot of big companies in Ventura County. Our big challenge now, and we're going to address it. I was talking with Dr. Gillespie. We found some software that is going to help us. It's matching the students we have and the adults who go through our programs with the available employment in the county. And we're going to be able to do a more significant job doing that in the future. So that's a future opportunity for us, because I think Ventura County is really, I read, we've all read the article in the Washington Post and in the LA Times that said that it's one of the best climates in America. So, you know, people are going to want to come here. So anyway, so that that part of it we are doing. A group has been formed here called P20. And I'm a big fan of P20 because it involves all the schools from preschool through Channel Islands, through doctoral degrees. And so my point simply is that the Ventura County Community Colleges are the nexus. The interesting thing about this county is our colleges serve the whole county. This is not characteristic of the state. Many states are broken into multiple community college districts and so forth. We have a communication opportunity here that is second to none in the state. We're probably potentially the best organized educational complex in the state to serve the needs of the employers in our county. So without going on, I'm going to shut up. I just want to put that on the table and say that we're available to talk with all of you about any opportunities you have, and we're looking to play a leadership role in helping bridge employees and employers.
That's great. Thank you, Dr. Luskin. Now I'd like to introduce Dr. Greg Gillespie. Dr. Gillespie has been serving as the president of Ventura College since the summer of 2013. He has worked for over 22 years in the community college system and served as a faculty member, director, dean, and vice president at four different community colleges in three states, with direct experience in instruction, administrative services, and student services. Dr. Gillespie is focused on Ventura College providing our community access to quality and relevant educational programs and services. Dr. Gillespie grew up near Yakima, Washington, and received a Bachelor of Science degree from Washington State University in agronomy which for you urbanites is crop science. He also received a Master of Science and a Doctor of Philosophy degree in the same discipline from North Dakota State University. Please welcome Dr. Greg Gillespie.
Thank you, James, and I would like to welcome all of you to Ventura College. It's a pleasure to have the opportunity to host this event. And, you know, at Ventura College, great things are happening. I'm just in my third year here, and during that time, it's been exciting to see what is happening both at the state level and local level to really start to increase the community college's ability to meet workforce needs that exist. You know, when you look at the role of community colleges and what's needed in the workforce, we can really work with business and industry to meet the need for employees in high demand areas. The state just this year has decided to invest just over $200 million in the workforce education programs at community colleges. And that's really going to help us better meet that need. But the key to making that be successful is for us to be working with employers so that we're offering relevant programming leading to jobs for our students in the communities where they're from. And having our community colleges working with our K through 12 partners and with our employers to make that happen will benefit all of us. So I think I'll kind of save the rest of my comments then for the questions. But again, welcome to Ventura College today. Thanks.
Thanks, Dr. Gillespie. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Michael Babb. Dr. Babb and his family have called Ventura home since 2001. He's a lifelong Californian with a deep belief in the power of a robust public school system. He's been superintendent of Ventura Unified School District since 2015. Dr. Babb studied English and journalism at CSU Sacramento and began teaching at Gardena High School in 1986. He taught in San Francisco, Sonoma County, and in Spain. He was the principal of E.P. Foster Elementary School in Ventura for 5 years. Dr. Babb earned a doctorate in educational leadership from the University of California at Los Angeles in 2008. He has been a professor in the Educational Leadership Master's Program at CSUCI since 2006. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Michael Babb.
Thank you very much. I've lived here since 2001. I have three kids. They all went through the Ventura Unified School District as students. Two of them are attending classes right now next door. We're on campus, right? So there, I can go down the hall and check up on them. Just keep them close to me. And my wife's a second grade teacher at Portola in here in Ventura too. And we, you know, I was thinking earlier about how 21st century learning for students is. We're moving towards 21st century learning in schools. You know, we're making changes. And it's an ironic thing to say, because most of the students, I think, except for this year's seniors and juniors, most of the students were born in the 21st century. They'll live their lives in the 21st century. They'll be nothing but 21st century people. And we're striving to make changes for 21st century element. So it's a funny thing. But one real important aspect of 21st century schooling has to do with making connections, and that's connections between people. That's connections between interests and society, and then connection to a sense of self and an interest beyond school. Someday I want to be this thing, and so I'm going to study this because I want to be this thing, or I'm interested in this realm. And so we're connecting more education towards the real world. Now, you heard my biography. I've been in the California public school system since 1965, and continuous, except for 1 year when I lived in Spain. But otherwise, I either was a student, I got my doctorate in California, and I've worked in California schools all that time. So making connections for students, and this is a real crucial thing, to career, most of us in schools have worked our whole career in schools. And, you know, we have relationships with people who are outside of the schools, but I think it's important that we really strengthen our relationships with the community and with the workforce so that we understand the needs of what the workforce is looking for in our students in terms of their capacity. And then you understand, too, the things that we're doing and how our system works so that you have so that you have shoppers as well as workers who are can adapt to your fields. And so I'll save my comments that are specific. We're doing a lot of work in this area, and I'm really pleased to be here today and to be able to talk about the changes that we're making towards the 21st century.
Great. Thanks, Dr. Babb. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Ed Gibbs, Sr. Mr. Gibbs has been the CEO and owner of Gibbs Truck Centers, Incorporated since 1976. Gibbs Truck Centers are franchise locations for the company International Trucks out of Chicago, Illinois, and Isuzu Trucks out of Irvine, California. Prior to that, he worked as a licensed CPA with Deloitte & Touche in Chicago. Mr. Gibbs received his Bachelor of Science and Commerce degree from the University of Santa Clara in 1972, and graduated from the Executive Development Program at the UCLA Anderson Graduate School of Business in 1991. Gibbs Truck Centers, in partnership with the Ventura County Community College District, is launching a diesel technology training program, which will start at Ventura College this coming fall. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Gibbs.
You know, I've never sat with three PhDs before. Hopefully some of that will migrate down this way. I've been a truck dealer for 40 plus years, and we've been home based here in Oxnard all that time. And so it's been a good run. We think, I don't know. I think we're the oldest car and truck dealer in Ventura County. I think there may be 101 that's pretty close, but we're proud of that. So that tells you that we've made it through a few cycles of ups and downs over the years. So what's a truck dealer? Same as an automobile dealer, but they're just a little bit, actually they're a lot bigger. But we sell two sizes of trucks. A medium-sized truck, which has a van or a flatbed or an aerial crane or a water tank, something mounted on a chassis. Or we sell those big trucks that scare you when you drive down the freeway. And they still scare me, and I've been around them my whole life. But frankly, those guys are very, very good drivers that drive those big trucks. Our traditional business as an automobile dealer is truck sales, new and used. We sell parts. We provide service for all categories of trucks. We have a body shop. We have rental departments. We just do about anything related to a truck. And from the service side of the business, we determined that we weren't winning as far as people was concerned. These trucks were becoming more complicated. Our big trucks have an engine life of 1,000,000 miles plus, which is absolutely incredible to a layman. But the knowledge behind how to repair those is something that one learns over a period of time. Young people today are not getting their hands dirty. They don't want to do it. And so I have locations here along the coast, and then I have locations through the San Joaquin Valley. And our need over there is a little bit different, but still a need. We have a dramatic need for qualified, well-trained diesel mechanics. And so semi-selfishly, we got to know Greg and his team and are close to starting our first semester in August of a two-year AA degree in diesel technology. So pretty exciting stuff.
Exciting stuff. I'm looking forward to the rest of what everyone has to say. So just so folks who are participating here know a little bit how we'll run this, We've got a number of questions that we've prepared for the panelists to answer. I'm going to ask them a number of those questions to give each of them a chance to share a little more. And then we'll take a pause from the scripted questions and give an opportunity for the participants, the attendees, you all, to ask questions as well. And then hopefully we'll be able to have a informing and engaging dialogue for the balance of our time here. So the first question I'm going to direct to Drs. Babb and Gillespie. And that question is, what has been your biggest accomplishment for each of your respective organizations this past year? And we'll go ahead and start with Dr. Gillespie, if that's okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you. Would really like to highlight three things. And one may seem a little unexciting to you, but it's real exciting and real important to us. And that is that we've been preparing for an accreditation visit that's coming up this fall. And so in preparation for that, we've been working on our accreditation self-study document that really provides us as a college community the opportunity to assess what we're doing as an institution, how well we're doing, and what we want to do to improve for the future. So I've been real proud of the way our college has pulled together to collaboratively prepare this document. We've had input from faculty, from our classified staff, from administrators, to all pull that together. All three of the community colleges have been doing that this year, and all of our first drafts went to the board at their meeting on Tuesday of this week. So we're very excited about that. And why accreditation is important? We need to maintain our accreditation to be able to access federal financial aid, which is critical for our students, and also to make sure that our credits transfer to other institutions. So we're looking forward to a successful visit in September. Next year, I'll be able to report back on the positive outcome that we'll have. The other thing that I'd like to mention that's a highlight is the completion of our Applied Science Center building. A number of you may have seen it. It's a new building off Telegraph. And I'll put in a plug for you to attend next year, because next year we hope to have this event there and be able to then show you some of the exciting things that are happening in that new building. As part of the building, we have an applied learning lab. And the applied learning lab will be supporting a number of things, but one of them is a new non-credit workplace essentials certificate program. This program helps to provide the basic entry-level needs that someone should acquire in order to be employed in the workplace. The workplace essentials curriculum will contain components in safety, in career exploration, what it means to be an effective employee, business writing, applied math, as well as principles of technology. So the students will have had some experience on hands-on simulators in which they will learn about measurement, and they'll learn about quality control, they can learn about electricity, hydraulics, a number of different things. So it's a pathway to employment, it's a pathway to further education in both our applied science degree areas, our two-year degrees, and our shorter-term certificates, as well as our STEM transfer programs. We're really excited with the fact that this program will be free to anyone because it's non-credit. And if you have, let's say as an employer, an employee who you would like to have them learn more about electricity, there's an electrical module, has different levels in it. They can access and learn about that online. They come in and they work on the simulators, and then there's an instructor there who can assess their competency in it, and they can get checked off with a certificate of completion for that module. So that's how it can help current workers upgrade skills. The other thing is it can train new workers as well for the workplace. So it's really a unique concept for Ventura College, and really unique concept for the whole area. So we're excited to be kicking that off this summer. And then thirdly, we have the startup of the diesel technology program this fall, which wouldn't have happened without the partnership with Ed Gibbs and his company, so we're really grateful to that partnership. They contributed nearly $1 million or over $1 million in direct contributions as well as in-kind contributions. Our students will take the class portion of the program here, and then they'll go down to Gibbs Truck Center in Oxnard to do the hands-on lab portion. They have two bays that we'll be using there. So those are three accomplishments that I'm delighted to share with you this afternoon. Thanks.
Thank you. Dr. Babb.
Well, for one, we're a people enterprise, and since I've started, and this was 10 months ago, we've hired 7 school leaders and 2 district level assistant superintendents. And so quite a bit of change in leadership. And when I rejoined the district in the fall, I talked to a group of principals about training, ongoing professional learning that they do. And what they're interested in going forward is more of an emphasis on instructional leadership. So besides finding great leaders for the schools, for the 17,500 students in our schools, there's also the idea of ongoing professional learning activities for them. So we've trained and participated in an activity that's called instructional rounds. And in instructional rounds, you learn a protocol for classroom observations and for looking at school improvement goals as a system and making recommendations for changes based on what's happening actually in the classroom. Principals nowadays are expected to spend more time in the classroom and making decisions based on evidence of learning in real time. So that was it's been quite an endeavor. And yesterday we were across the street over at Foothill Technology High School training that group. So that'll continue over time because that's something that really, it's an iterative process that takes time to develop skill in, but all the principals have been trained in it and are first in it and are using it at different levels at their school site. So that's something that's been those two bringing new leaders into the fold, which is so important, and then training for them. And then the other thing that I want to talk about too is we're continuing to develop a career technical education program in the school district. And that's something that's really a pre-K adult school enterprise, because research tells us that, and I've seen this too, but students start to identify or want to identify with careers pretty early in primary school, you know, primary children. And actually a focus on career and technical education early in a child's schooling shows gains overall in student achievement. Part of that just has to do with finding oneself and finding one's voice, and then being, learning that what I'm learning in school has some applicability in what I'm interested in. More and more, education is becoming personalized, less standardized, more focused on student learning goals. And so that's a big part of change all over the U.S., but especially in Ventura Unified, as we've joined forces with other school districts, and then also with the County Office of Education, with the community college system too, to define goals for career technical education, and then improving our systems for teaching career technical education. So one thing that arose out of that specifically is this collaborative. So people are doing this work all over the state, but there's some really good people in the county that are doing this work, and we're working together to define not only what goals are, but career pathways are being developed. And a pathway it's a set of classes that prepare students for a career pathway of their interest. For example, it might be medical, it might be law, education. And so there's been different efforts that have been put in to get that going. And there's a baseline course. Most of the work's in the secondary program from middle school to adult. but one new innovation is that beginning in the fall, all ninth graders are going to take a course that's a seminar course in college and career readiness. And as I say college and career readiness, over the last, you know, if you have students, if you have children who are my kids' age, who just finished the K-12 environment, the big focus was on standards for learning that are going to prepare students for college. And it was a really big college, mostly college, that was the push, that kids were going to be at a certain ability level in numeracy and literacy skills that would prepare them for college. And not all through that that time, often I would hear teachers say, well, not all kids are going to go to college, not all kids are interested in college. But now we're more on, not that we don't want them to go to college, we do want them to go to college, but that the hook is career. So that ninth grade course is going to be a big focus, not only on looking at what I'm interested in, how I like to work, what things are important to me, my own personal values, but also what work I might be interested in and why, education level I'm going to need to have to do that work. And then a big part of it is finance, like what it's going to cost me. And also, when I get a career, what kind of a lifestyle am I looking for, and what does that really mean? I mean, it's such a, you know, if you just understand how money works is a big financial literacy aspect of that course. So all kids in high schools will take that course, and then that could lead to a pathway, which would be two or more courses that are in that area of interest. And we have defined career technical pathways among the state, but there's also going to be some development here that'll be for local needs. And a lot of the work that's being done with BC Innovates is actually in collaboration with business too. And so I think that's a really important part of it, for what I said earlier, is that the connection between where students are gonna work and how we're preparing them has to be meshed. We need to really work, you know, together on this to make sure that the programs that students are learning, or the machines that they're learning on, that they are actually the same ones that are going to be used in the workplace. I always, you know, the workplace is changing too. People I know who are who own businesses or who work in other fields, their work is constantly changing. So we want to make sure that our preparation prepares them for a changing work environment. And so those would be some highlights for this first year.
That's great. Thanks, Dr. Babb. I think that's very interesting, because reflecting on my own educational experience, college prep was, it was all about college prep. And my personal experience was very little about, you know, what are you going to do with that? It was more that this is the college degree is the ticket to the happy outcome. And it's exciting to hear about developments that are happening in both of your institutions about connecting students' educational experiences from a very early age to what they're going to get their hands on when they're actually in the workplace, since, as we know, that's where where we spend most of our lives. So, and I'd actually be interested, Mr. Gibbs, in your take on the connection, at least from your own experience, somebody who's been in business for many years and also has a lot of familiarity with educational institutions by virtue of the degrees you've earned. If you have any reflections on the role of education in preparing our future workforce for the specific jobs you're going to do, in terms of the college orientation versus a career orientation, and maybe some of your reflections on that from your experience.
Yes, I think most of you remember Jack O'Connell, who was the superintendent of schools for the state, and Jack was a very firm believer in traditional education. I'm going back 20, 25 years ago or so. I'm not so sure I always agreed with that, because traditional education doesn't fit everybody's bill, from my perspective. There's got to be an opportunity to go into a valid profession, earn a good wage, and have you do something, have the student or the have a career opportunity in something besides being fully educated. Now, that said, there is, from my perspective, from my chair, there is a link. And one of the things, and we were working with Greg and his people, was, you know, we didn't want just training in diesel technology. We wanted training in reading, specifically in writing, in math, and in computer science, because all of those ingredients are good for the student traditionally, and also help them do what we're going to hire them for. In other words, when they do a repair, they electronically write it up, so they need to know how to write, because at the end of the day, we take that, we do edit it, because it goes to the customer, but they need to be able to express what they've done, okay? There's math involved, because everything today with an electronic reader is analytics and what that's telling you. So I'm kind of giving you a long answer, but I'm a believer in vocational ed with a lot of the traditional learning centers kind of thrown in.
That's great. Thank you. And Dr. Luskin, I'm wondering, could you share for us some of what you see as specific challenges that Ventura County faces with respect to this topic in terms of preparing students for the workforce?
I made a note to myself because I'm a psychologist, and I wrote down identity psychology. I haven't quite figured this out yet. You know, career choice is a function of an individual's self-perception and the personal identity and the ability to identify with something that they're going to do. So one size doesn't fit all. And I mentioned, as I was putting these materials together for this talk that I was going to do, a presentation I was going to do next week, I counted more than 60 specific occupational programs that we have in the three colleges of the Ventura County Community College District. And just as a point, we serve about 50,000 students a year, full-time students probably 32, 33,000. So there are a lot of people making a lot of different choices. And one of the things that I think we need to do, and I comment about P20 because I have great hope for that in the future, but there was some legislation passed, and I see that we've set up a new office. I'm not going to go on long, and I see Vice Chancellor Rick Post is here, and it's called Educational Services. It combines academic affairs and student services, so we can do that. And a new piece of legislation has passed the legislature. It's AB 288, and it's got to do with dual enrollment, and we're very eager to work with Stan Mantooth and the county, all the schools. We're eager to work with Dr. Babb in dual enrollment, where you take courses in high school, you get high school credit, you get college credit at the same time, and you get a leg up. So that by the time you go to college, maybe there are places in the country that where the student can get an AA degree and a high school diploma at the same time. So the point is matching this information and career information with all these 60 careers, or with the traditional transfer stuff that you got put together, is a big challenge to us because we're a big county. So working together to doing that is a challenge that we face right now, in addition to the one point that I mentioned in the beginning, which is finding a way to match available career opportunities and jobs in our county with the actual people who are going to take them. Because it's good to theorize, but it's better to actually do something. and so I'm looking at actually doing something by matching the students we have with the jobs that there are and helping them be better informed.
That's great. Thank you, Dr. Luskin. You want to add to that, Dr. Gillespie?
Yeah, excuse me.
Thank you.
Would just like to add a little bit more around the topic of Ventura County Innovates to this question here, because, you know, it's been, I think we're in the third year of Ventura County Innovates now, which is a $15.3 million grant that our area received from the state that includes funding to the community colleges, to all of the area high school districts, as well as the Ventura County Office of Education. The outcome of VC Innovates will be that we will have established, I think it'll be over 70 career pathways. Those career pathways will provide the opportunity for students in the high schools who are in their career pathway to obtain college credit for one or more of their articulated courses at the high school level, make the connection with the community college program, move into that, and after the community college program, move into employment. So our challenge is to really make those pathways work by collaborating together. And we can't do that without the support of the business and industry employers in our area here. So I know that through VC Innovates, they've really been working to develop all of those connections. But, you know, at the end of it, what'll happen if we use automotive technology as a example? We have a automotive technology program here at Ventura College. It's a Toyota T10 certified program. The graduates who complete that, all of them get employed right away. They're looking at making, you know, $45,000 to $50,000 a year coming out, which is good for your 2-year degree. They can, at the area high schools that have automotive programs, start that pathway in high school, get some of the credit in the high school, then move to the college, and then move into employment. The key thing that makes this work, not in automotive, but in all 70 of those pathways, is the support of work-based learning that occurs in the classes. And that work-based learning can be guest speakers coming in from industry, it can be going on field trips, and it can be internships. None of those work-based learning activities happen without the involvement of our employers. So that's one way where you can help and connect with us, is through our Ventura County Innovates industry liaisons and being willing to participate in one or more of those three ways there.
Great. Thanks, Dr. Gillespie. Now I'd like to give our audience an opportunity to ask some questions. Anybody want to chime in, ask one of our panelists a question or something for the group as a whole? Tina. Yeah.
I have a question directed to Dr. Gillespie, and that's involved. I'm on the Ventura Chamber Green Task Force, which is one of the committees, and so I'm concerned about environmental issues. And so my question was, has the college ever considered offering like permaculture classes and things like that? I know there's a water science program.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Did everyone hear the question?
Okay. We do have a water science program, and that's one of our more popular programs now, and that does train individuals to really become certified freshwater or wastewater operators, which is a high-demand field area. But they also learn about water as a resource and its conservation and care. We're in the process of getting an agriculture program restarted here at the college. And as we get that faculty member on board, that could be an area where some interest could develop, which would be the permaculture and other sustainable production type of methods there. Right now with agriculture, we'll be getting transfer degree options going in agribusiness management and plant science or crop production, but we would like to get some certificates and short degree programs in some areas of identified need here in the county, which we're working with employers on further defining.
Thanks. Go ahead, yes.
Mr. Kennedy. This is for Mr. Gibbs. And once your 2-year program is complete, then how do you think we could help you, the community college district, continue to upgrade and keep your workforce up to date on all the changes? There's so much computer science and other things, technology. Would there be a way you could link it with Ventura College to keep going continuously for lifelong, career-long learning with your workforce?
That's a good question. It would be our hope that this program would go on and continue, because in our industry today, we've got about 100,000 technicians short across the country. So this is not Gibbs Truck Center's issue. It's a U.S. issue. We're just not attracting people to the profession. So to be more specific to your question, it would be our hope to continue the process and build upon it. And I think one of the reasons college was so receptive to it is they have done, from our chair, an exemplary job, a terrific job on this Toyota program. They understand the need. I think Dr. Gillespie would tell you that for each of those guys that are in that those gentlemen that are in that program, I don't know whether there's any women. I don't mean to cut the women out, but
there's a few.
They could, each of them probably has two or three or four job opportunities out of school. That's how much demand there is even in the automobile business. So it is our hope that we'll continue in some format. I think the college has gone through all the necessary steps to make sure, one, that we're getting a program of curriculum that would be, in our lingo, NATEF certified. It's the people that certify these programs. And so they're doing all the right things to make sure that we have continuity of this program. I would hope it's just not a shot in the dark. It's something that would sustain itself.
And Mr. Gibbs, if I can just ask you to elaborate. Sure. We're talking about the problem specifically here because of your expertise regarding diesel technology and technicians in that field. We've talked a little bit about automotive technicians. What is the problem, and how does that impact your business?
Well, the problem is no entry into the field, and even more so here. Because even though they have a noble profession, the biggest issue we deal with is they all, after 5 or 6 years, they all want to buy a house. They're married by then, or close to getting married. They want to make enough money to be able to, like all of us did, be able to buy a house. And so they perceive that this opportunity won't take them there. And then, frankly, it's harder where we live in Ventura County, in the San Joaquin, in our Fresno store, in our Bakersfield store, and our Tulare store. A starting wage of $45,000 or $50,000. Very soon they graduate from that. They can buy a house in those areas. We're still going to be fighting this here, and we're just going to have to be more adaptive as time goes on.
Thank you.
Can I say something about what?
Yeah, Dr. Babb, go ahead.
It just makes me think like the idea of college and career. I think that in some of our minds, it's college or career. You know, I'll go to high school until. And then I'm going to start a job, and then that's it for school. But most jobs are going to require that level of you just said adaptation, but adaptivity. I take continuing courses, and most of us, you know, a lot of us do. And that's going to be the nature of the, you know, 21st century workforce. Our current kindergartners are very likely to live into the 22nd century. It's, you know, the odds are that most of them will. And the jobs that they're going to be doing this year's kindergartners, a lot of them haven't been created yet. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we're preparing them for something that doesn't even exist yet. So we really do, it's really important for us to focus on the idea that there's learning to be done. Learning is part of life. You know how to learn. You come into a new problem, or there's a development in an industry or in your job, and you're going to have the skills and the confidence to be able to say, well, I'll take a crack at that. It's a little bit different from what I've been doing, but I know I need to learn something. I know how to set goals for learning. I know how to do it. So that's a real important part of it. You know, like a lot of times the traditional European model of at a certain point when I'm an early adolescent, I get to decide, like the game of life, to go that way towards a job or that way towards a career. Now they're kind of, we're interrelating them, that you might have a job, you'll have a job maybe, but there's going to be some aspect of you're going to the community college to build your skills while you're working, or some level of internship, or but they're not exclusive, they're together.
Yes.
I'm glad I'm here in this front of this business community crowd, because when I first got on the board about 6 years ago, we were still in the midst of painful cuts to programs and services given the economy at the time. Thank goodness for Prop 30 that gave us an infusion of money. Thank goodness for the VC Innovates grant programs. But with Prop 30, at least a portion of it about to sunset, what discussions, what planning, what support movement, if any, and I would almost want to ask the crowd that same question, is being undertaken at this point in time?
I do know that there's efforts being made to put on the ballot in November a proposal to extend Prop 30. And so There's been about 1 million signatures obtained to do that, and that's been presented then, I think, to the governor's office to validate. I think they need a little over 500,000 signatures to get that on the ballot. But Prop 30, even though it was meant to be a temporary measure, if it goes away, it would lead to budget reductions and cuts in both by the K through 12 system as well as the community college system. So, you know, one of two things need to happen if we're going to maintain the level of service that we have currently. One is that Prop 30 continues, and that would allow for that revenue to be there. Or if it goes away, there's a redistribution of state funds to provide the equivalent dollars back into the K through 12 and community college systems. You know, the community colleges serve over 2.1 million students each year here in the state of California. I think at its high, it was about 2.5 million. So even with Prop 30, we're still serving fewer students than we were. So it's not in the interest of the state, it's not in the interest of our economy to really cut the funding to community colleges and serve fewer students and be preparing fewer workers when the demand is really we need to be producing more community college and college graduates at this point in time. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens. From my standpoint, looking at our institution, yeah, it'll be critical for Prop 30 to continue or, again, for the state to come up with another way to fund the colleges moving ahead. We've been fortunate in that the state has been funding CTE programs more these last 2 years, the career technical ed programs, and we need that funding because there are more expensive programs to run. Because you can imagine, even the new diesel technology program we're getting going, I think it has a capacity of around 25 students with one instructor plus all of the equipment that each student needs to be developing and learning those skills versus one instructor teaching psychology courses that may have, you know, 60 students per class. The costs are considerably higher. Yet it's our responsibility to really be developing new career tech ed programs for the jobs that we have now and into the future, plus enhancing the ones that we have. So the state's providing some dollars for us to do that, but that needs to be able to continue long term.
If you can, I'm going to say add a little bit, and that's to the VC Innovates grant. When it does go away, the goals that the goals to create these pathways to enhance communication and to help prepare students for post-secondary, either college or career. A lot of that's capacity building. So over the course of the grant, the capacity is going to be developed. That's not to say there's not going to be more work to be done. There will be more work to be done, but a lot of the communication structures will exist, and it'll be important for us to have resources. But I do want to underscore the fact that VC Innovates creates a lot of the infrastructure and capacity that will help the work as it moves along.
Great, thank you. And Dr. Luskin, did you want to weigh in on the Prop 30 question as well?
I think Dr. Gillespie described that pretty well. I mean, we'll see what happens. I think the state's still in moderately decent shape now. The recovery, as it is continuing. If I was to make a comment, I would say the state of education in Ventura County is good. Somebody else, that's a paraphrase, but it's I just think we should see how it goes. I would make add one comment, though. This is an effort to throw out a creative notion because there are community leaders in here. I mean, that's who you all are. You all have certainly my email or Greg's email or Dr. Babb's email. If you have a thought on some kind of program idea, send it and I mean, a lot of things are just as a result of communication. I promise that we will respond, and we'll sort these things out. A program in L.A. that has always intrigued me was called POP, Police Officer Opportunity Program. The interesting thing about it was it tied K-12 into the community college, into the LAPD, and these students who went through these programs were guaranteed a position on the LAPD if they completed the sequence of programs and passed the exams. Well, it doesn't isolate itself to police science or fire science. There must be occupational areas in our county. I don't know whether it's in automotive or healthcare or where you can set up some kind of structure that is a pathway guarantee to employment so that these people have a real finalized, comfortable target that they can see as they go, as they begin to develop. So I just wanted to get that in as a thought.
That's great. Thank you. And along those lines, I wonder, and this isn't directed to any particular panelist, but what ideas our panel has about developing further collaboration between educational institutions here in Ventura and Ventura County and the business community, and what opportunities there are for that kind of collaboration.
Well, one thing that would be important is that we have our programs are only as good as they serve the community. And I think it's important that we get advice from you when we're developing a pathway, from you who are actually going to employ the students who we're sending out. So I think that's really important, is as we're developing our programs, we do a bit of this with advisement and say, this is, you know, take a look at our curriculum, take a look at our enhanced for job embedded, you know, activities like internships or job shadowing or visits to plants or guest speakers or this kind of thing, and look how they can be enhanced and adapted to reflect, you know, right. So that would be that'd be one real key.
Thanks. Yeah, Dr. Gillespie.
And you know, one thing that would help is to actually think of the community colleges as a source of employees for you, and to think about how can we make the students aware of the job opportunities that exist. How can we help you as employers get the employees that you need? As part of our, again, Applied Science Center, we are going to be getting a software program up and running that's designed to help facilitate that connection. We're going to have certain of our programs that we'll pilot this year where students in those programs will be developing portfolios online. They'll have a resume they're updating. There'll be a list of their classes, of the certificates they've earned, what degree they're they're working towards. Employers can have access then to this database of students and can be able to do a search on the database, identify potential employees from our students that meet those requirements, contact them, and interview them. The other thing is, too, students would be able to see jobs that are out there with the different employers. So again, in order to make this system work, it will require us to work together to make that connection happen. But it would be another thing that's unique to our area that I hope would benefit us as we're looking to try to match students with jobs in the area. And a lot of the students that we have, you know, some have an idea of getting a community college certificate, some getting just a two-year degree, getting a job, some transferring. But regardless, anybody that's in college, ultimately their goal is to get a job, to get a career. And a lot of our students need to have jobs along the way of that process, either while they're in school or they'll stop out for a couple years and work, come back to school. So again, having this employer community college connection can really help with that.
Great, thank you. Gentlemen, I'll take this gentleman first and then we'll come back to you. You can go ahead.
Great calling.
Okay,
yeah.
Great.
So just to shamelessly plug, we have a VC Innovates Join Us opportunity
which really is, you know, you do this either now with these cards or on our website, vcinnovates.org, and the Join Us tab. And that really is your opportunity to say, I'm interested in getting connected in some way with what's going on in the county. So, from the guest speaking, you know, through mentorships, internships, you know, all sorts of opportunities. So, you can do this right now, or you can go to our website and you can join us tab.
Thank you. And did you want to add to that? Yeah.
So, everybody was here. My name is Gerald Gooden. I'm also with BC Innovates, but one of the things I wanted to point out was Dr. Babb explained that BC Innovates is helping to build capacity to connect industry and companies to education. But one of the things in response to that, it hit me that if we get it right, because we are building capacity, and you know, we may go away if the design calls for, but the sustainability part of that is that the connections to the companies, if we pull it off right, becomes a pool system in which the Applied Science Center has all these offerings, but in fact, companies like Gibbs or Era, whomever, could actually go there and make sure that the requirements for that company are being addressed, as was mentioned, and the capacity has been built out and then becomes a pool system where companies are pulling as well as co-designing. I just thought that was an interesting point.
Great, thank you. Yes.
I also just want to encourage on the other side prospective employers to think about the employees that you have working with you when they need updated or enhanced skills to consider the Ventura College, you know, business in our colleges for increasing their skills or improving skills so that they can be promoted and move on in their careers as well. And that's just part of that ongoing, it's like you don't go to college and you get a degree and you're just done there. You start in the workforce, you may start entry level or wherever you start, but then you're always increasing and improving upon your skills. And so consider that as well.
Thank you. And I'll just throw out, when I think about ongoing education, for instance, for myself personally, and I'm wrestling with Excel and for the fourth time going to the help menu to try and figure out how it works, my first thought is, well, do I want to sign up for lynda.com? It's not, maybe I should go to VC and sign up for a class. And part of that is because, you know, there's low commitment if I'm doing it online at my house at 9 o'clock after the kids go to bed versus signing up for a class. But I'm wondering what the panel thinks about those online options that are in the general marketplace versus the offerings that some of our public educational institutions offer for continuing education and folks asking those kinds of questions.
I would make...
Certainly, Dr. Lester.
I think there are two types of online opportunities. There are those that you mentioned, like lynda.com and the MOOCs and Spooks and all these other programs that are out there. They're fine, you know, I mean, because how do you learn? You learn any way you can. So there are those kinds of programs. I just want to point out that there's a distance learning initiative going on in California among all of the community colleges and across the country. About 20% of our enrollment now is in online courses, and the education pattern, you know, it's not all or nothing at all. People take classroom courses, they take blended courses with classroom and online activity, and they take courses that are online. To the extent that these kinds of programs that you're talking about, Excel and accounting and all these things, are important, and busy adults need flexible time during the day, increasing the number of offerings we have is a good idea. It's going to happen anyway, because that's the way the future is coming toward us, and it's becoming more. So the more formalized, more highly developed courses will be, I think, more effective, and they're going to increase, and it's a big part of what we're doing now. So I think it's worth knowing about that, especially since this is an industry education meeting and people at work can take them on their own schedules.
Great. Thank you. This gentleman here. Yes.
I have two things. One, I just want to mention that there is another institute nearby, which is Ventura College Education, and they basically fill in the gaps from K-12 education, maybe adults that, you know, need something in addition to that, but maybe aren't quite ready for a community college. And also, they have been doing a very robust career technical education program for many, many years, and we're very successful in both providing education and also of having people find jobs that they provide. And then my question is, you know, based on the things that you're saying, what are some of the challenges that you believe are on the horizon in order to maintain the direction that you're going?
Well, as we're developing these pathways, one of the challenges is the certification that the teachers need to have, and also workforce experience, and then finding people with lining up the industries with the classrooms and other. But some of that's one thing. The other would be I talked a little bit earlier about the maintaining connections with business and relevance to the program, and making sure that, you know, looking over our course offerings and looking at the activities that we're exposing students to, making sure that they're relevant to what you're expecting in the community. And the other is resources, is these career pathways are kind of more specialized, fewer kids will take them, so the cost of them is going to be higher. So when I talked earlier and said that, you know, Ventura Innovates is going to be a self-sustaining capacity building kind of program, that's true. But these courses are usually going to, I think they're going to tend towards the more expensive side. So money.
Okay, Dr. Luskin and then Dr. Glassman.
Oh, just a comment. It was not a trivial comment to say that the state of the education in Ventura County is good. I actually meant it. The reason I'm saying that is it's not so much the challenges, it's the opportunities. This is a great group. It brings together the chambers. There are chambers throughout the county. The evolution of and capitalizing on opportunity is a function of working together, businesses, industry, partnerships, on a program-by-program basis. And the people who manage the industries in this county have as much a responsibility to reach to us as we have to reach to them. We have to know who they are. Getting together and focusing, every major occupational area in this county where there's opportunity for people to have a career should have an advisory committee that has some kind of communication within itself that involves people who are practitioners in the field and also providing academic services.
Thank you. Dr. Gillespie.
And one thing that I would add is that, you know, a current challenge right now is that 70% of the students that come to Ventura College need one or more developmental course in English or math, and that is a challenge. Now, with that, how do we address that and how do we handle it? Well, there's a couple of things. We're starting a new program that's going to be called Sail to Success, where our college is going to have our student services area, our classroom instruction, our scheduling designed to where every first-year student is supported to complete college-level English and math during their first year. That overcomes that barrier right away and gets them to the point to where they are college-ready and can move on. We'd also like to try to lower that 70% number of the students that we're working with needing that. This is where connections with industry, VC Innovates can help, because once students, whether that's in middle school, high school, can get excited about something, develop a passion for something, see the relevance to why they're in school about something, that can be the key thing that helps them be more successful and come to the college prepared and ready and retains to that point to where they're employed. So I'm really looking forward to that, and that's where, again, as employers, you can help through the internships, mentorships, field trips, the guest speaking, anything that connects those students early in that pathway to really engage them in the educational process is going to help all of us there.
Great. Okay. Yeah, I wanted to add a little piece about engagement that it sparked this connection to this book that's out that's called The Coming Job War, which is, I would recommend, it's a really interesting book. But I think about we were really determined and focused for the last decade and before that even on graduation rate. It's a really important criteria for us that, you know, we want to have a low, if any, non-graduates. And we're our school district's relative, you know, 95% graduate according to the last cohort, but there's still 77 who don't. So to me, it's like I was that kind of teacher that, you know, I might have gotten 99.9%, but I want to make sure that I got them all. And so this had this quote that had to do with that students, Gallup says that students drop out when they lose hope to graduate, okay? Or they lose, you know, they lose hope to something relevant to them. So I want to read this quote real quick. The reason they lose hope of graduating is because they don't feel excited about what's next in their lives. The moment they feel that despair about what is ahead, they start psychologically dropping out. Having no vision or excitement for the future is the cause of dropping out in school. Students need to be rescued at or before the moment they lose hope in the future. When they aren't caught in time, they don't just drop out of school, they drop out of life. And so it makes it one of those things where I think that this this level of commitment to students to help them find what matters to them, it's such a crucial aspect of our work.
That's a great point to end on, Dr. Babb. I appreciate that. I'll just share a few comments, and then we'll conclude our program. But the thing that stands out to me about what each of these four individuals is doing and the way they're engaging with the educational system right now is really it comes down to giving individual students hope for their future. And thinking back on my own experience, the thought is always, what are you going to do when you grow up? You know, and first it was a race car driver, then it was an astronomer, and then it was I have no idea for many, many years, right? And then I became a lawyer, so watch out. But it really is about giving students hope and a sense that when they're in school and they're learning things, that's going to connect to a good outcome for them. Some of us came from families where we take that for granted. Some of us came from families where you can't take that for granted. And it's so critical that institutions like our public schools imbue that into the kids who spend so much of their day in that context with a sense of, this is connected something to something bigger. This is connected to a future that makes sense and is going to work. Whatever else is going on for my life, I can get somewhere with this. So thank you to each of you for being engaged in that process, especially to Mr. Gibbs for the way that you're thinking proactively about helping get people jobs through the existing educational system we have. We think that's a great example of the kind of partnerships that make our educational environment here in Ventura really special. And you've had an opportunity to hear about some of the specific features of that, whether it's the Toyota program or the VC Innovates program, things that make Ventura a great place to live and work and raise our kids above and beyond, you know, the weather and the surf, or however you connect with the ambient environment that the Washington Post said so much about. It's these kind of institutional things that exist here that are treasures that are the envy of many other communities. So let's thank our panelists for sharing.
Thank you.
In closing, there are a few organizations I would like to thank again. I'd like to thank Ventura College, of course, for hosting us, Ventura Unified School District, Brooks Institute, DJ's Catering for a great lunch, thank you, DJ's, CAPS Media, and once again, all of our sponsors and Chairman Circle members. Thank you all for coming, and make it a great day.